Hiya folks, it's Kikoskia here, and welcome back to Writing and Me. This video contains no music or gameplay whatsoever, allowing you to put this in the background and focus on whatever it is you're doing, be it writing yourself, playing a game, or trying to get the Supreme Candle from the Temple of Nu. Now I must caution you if you're going to get the Supreme Candle. There are only two ways into the temple, and both of them are very dangerous. If you choose to go through the front entrance, you're probably going to be hit by the time trap, which will send you so far back in time that you will die before the architect that even thinks about building the Temple of Nu is born. If you decide to go through the back entrance, you'll have to fight the 17th-headed Time Manticore, who has time breath that, you guessed it, will send you so far back in time that you will die before the Temple of Nu is even conceived. The only way to protect yourself from either of these is the mystical time amulet, which ironically is so far back in time that you actually want to fall victim to the trap so that you can get the thing that will protect you from the traps. Time and time again, people fall victim to the traps and then spend the rest of their lives trying to get that amulet, and then they bring it a tiny bit further forward in time. After about 20 or 30 more people, it may be the case that somebody could actually be able to get the time amulet and then go into the temple. But that is not you, I'm afraid. You're still about 20 or 30 people away, so be careful. It's not likely you're going to be able to get past those traps, so if you're going to go to the Temple of Nu, think twice. Now, as for today's topic, I'm going to be talking about something that is a very scary thing for all writers, whatever they write, be it fiction, non-fiction, crime stories, science fiction, romance stories. Every single person that writes thinks about this every once in a while, and there's a lingering sense of dread. For folks, I'm going to be talking today about writer's block. And I know a few people that are listening right now have just winced because they've been reminded of the time that they had writer's block. I believe everybody at some point falls victim to writer's block. Fortunately, it's something that you can deal with. But to deal with it, you have to start at the very beginning and ask yourself, what is writer's block? Put simply, writer's block is when writing becomes nigh impossible to do. It becomes exceptionally difficult to continue a project, regardless of what it is, and you'll spend hours upon hours struggling to get just a few words, if you even get that. Sometimes you will just stare at the text and nothing will come, and try what you might, you make no progress. That is writer's block. It is frustrating, it is stressful, and it just really gets under your skin because you know you want to write. You're sat there, you've dedicated time to this, and yet nothing is appearing. And you know that stuff can appear, stuff has appeared before, but nothing is there. It's just blank or next to blank, and anything you do write down not only is forced and strained, but you then look back at it and you think, that's not even any good. I'm not making any progress here. That is writer's block. And as I said, pretty much everyone has struggled with it at some point. I certainly have. I've gone through very long periods where I've not written anything at all. There is a difference between writer's block and simply not writing, though. If you can write, but you're simply choosing not to write, that is not writer's block. But there are a lot of things that cause writer's block that you wouldn't think are actually linked to it. So what causes writer's block? The most obvious thing that people think about is that the person who's writing runs out of inspiration. They run out of ideas, the plot heaters out, or they run out of references if it is a non-fiction work. They get to a point where they can't progress anymore. They have nothing. They're running on empty. And running on empty when you are writing is awful. Trust me, I have done it. It is an absolute struggle as you desperately try and conjure up something from a barrel of nothing. Have you tried getting something from nothing? Have you tried going, I'm going to reach into this bag of crisps and pull out a... Oh, there's nothing here. What if I just reach a little further? No, there's still nothing there. just a little further, and there is nothing in there but air and crumbs. And you are reaching for those crumbs, hoping that if you get enough of those crumbs, you can get something that even vaguely constitutes a bite of food. That is just the glimmer of the feeling of running on empty. But it's not the only cause of writer's block. One major cause is external factors. If you are in a situation where there are all kinds of external things that are pushing and tugging at you from different angles and forcing you not only to devote time to different things, but also to devote your thinking to different things, that can cause writer's block, and it can cause writer's block quite severely. Writing is not just physically exerting, it's also mentally taxing. You put a lot into the writing process, and once you're done for the day, you can feel quite drained. If that mental fortitude is being taxed and taken up by something else, it will show when you sit down to write. There are many times when my life has been especially stressful and hectic, and I sit down wanting to write, and it's just not happening. It's not happening because I'm not writing at the right time, and when I am writing, my thoughts are somewhere else, and they're thinking about the thing that I'm stressing about that's happening over the week, and everything is working against you writing. Your mind is occupied, and if this week is also a tiring one, you're working exceptionally hard, long hours, you're getting in, and you're absolutely exhausted. Sitting down to write when you're absolutely exhausted and it's exceptionally late and your body is just pleading for sleep is definitely going to contribute towards writer's block. You are going to sit there, you are really going to want to write, but your body just goes, "Ugh, really? You want me to write now? We need to go to bed. We have less than 6 hours before we get up and go to work again. We can't write. My brain is mush. Do not write. Go to sleep. Eat some food. Just do something that's not writing." But you sit there and you force yourself to write, and that is writer's block there. Another thing that causes writer's block is a lack of confidence. If your confidence in your writing is severely shaken, that can cause writer's block. This is often caused by people deciding to show off their work, typically to the wrong people, and the reception they get is overwhelmingly negative. The right kind of reception you want to get is you want feedback, you want constructive criticism, you want to know what is working, you want to know what isn't working, and what you could potentially improve. But you can show it to people and they will just look at this and laugh at you and proclaim that it is trash. And that will really heavily hit your confidence. It doesn't even have to be a hit to your confidence revolving around your writing. If something else knocks your confidence and damages your self-esteem, that will contribute towards a writer's block. Writer's block, I found, happens quite a few times for me because of my low self-esteem. I look at my writing and tend to think, by default, this isn't any good. But that is just one of the many things about the creative process. A lot of people are exceptionally critical about their own work. And when they present it to people for feedback, and that criticism is reinforced by bad advice and bad feedback, that can lead towards writer's block even more. So we have this cocktail of running out of ideas and inspiration, external factors that are causing this, and we have things like a lack of confidence as well. There is also taking on a project that is just too grand. This is something that I've done at least once. I've thought to myself, I will do this thing, and this thing will be amazing, and then I sit down. And then I start writing, and then suddenly I realize, oh, this is a huge project. I don't even know where to begin with this. And thus, the writer's block strikes pretty much after the first hurdle. I get started, and then the massive scale of what I've decided to undertake appears and goes, "Hello, I hear you want to do this project. I'm terribly sorry, but I am literally a mountain that you must overcome, and you brought a stepladder." I wish you luck, but I don't think luck is what you need right now. There are many stories throughout history of people trying to write their magnum opus, their epic, and they failed because they went out to try and achieve it. They purposely went out to write something so sweeping and grandiose that they were felled by their own ambition. It's not the way you typically hear writer's block striking, but it is something that definitely can happen, and you need to watch out for that. And so you're in this rut. But how do you get out of the rut? How do you deal with writer's block? There is no one universally accepted method of dealing with writer's block. Much like how everybody writes differently and everybody has different ways of compiling information for their writing and everything else, everybody will ultimately deal with writer's block in a different way. Some people will look at writer's block and they will give up, but I encourage you not to give up. Don't give up on writing because of writer's block. Don't let writer's block beat you. The first step I would recommend is to have that mindset. Writer's block has got the first blow, but don't reel from that blow. Bounce back by knowing that writer's block will eventually pass. It is not an eternal desert of nothing. It may be a small desert of very little, but you will get to the other side of it, and there are greener and more pleasant pastures on the other side. So you've got that mindset, but what else do you need? There are a few things I can recommend, a few things that have worked for me. One thing that has really worked is assessing the situation that you are in. Understanding what things are causing the writer's block is a great way of dealing with it. If you take a step back from the writing, which is counterintuitive because you think you really want to be there writing, but what you actually need to do is step back and assess the situation. Find out what is causing the writer's block. If you get a wider picture, you can look and diagnose and go, ooh, maybe it's the fact that I'm working a lot more on the weekends, the time when I normally write. So when I come back, I'm tired, I'm a little stressed, I'm hungry. Ooh, maybe I'm not eating well enough on the weekends. That's probably something that I should deal with. And slowly but surely, you come up with solutions, little things that will help out. Because if you can lessen the stress and the anxiety and the fatigue, you can work towards feeling better. And the better you feel, the more likely it is that you will be able to get through that writer's block. It's not guaranteed, of course, but it's always good to make yourself feel better regardless. It's always good to assess how you're doing and act to make things better. Another thing that can definitely help is assessing where you are in the writing. Don't go forward with the actual writing of the narrative. Look at where you are and analyze, assess, and from that, draw where you need to go next. You'll do this by making lists, by assembling diagrams with complicated arrows, with arrows pointing to various different things. And all of this not only helps you determine where you need to go, it also helps you work through what in the story is making this writer's block happen. As an example, you could make a timeline of events in the story. You take all of the events that have already happened, and the events that you know will happen, and you put them there on that timeline, and you see the gap. There is a gap here, and there's also a gap there and a little gap there, but you have things in the future of the story that you can aim towards, and just seeing that there, seeing all that you've already achieved, seeing what you know you're going to get to, that can help trigger something in your head that will tell you where the story is going next. The visual aid has assisted you in that endeavor. There could also, another example could be if you're having difficulty working out how characters interact with each other and what they think of one another. If you make a diagram with your characters and loads of arrows pointing towards the various people and saying if they like each other, dislike each other, love each other, hate each other, envious, and all these things, this can help you. This and the cue cards that you've hopefully made, or the documents that have all the information about your characters, going over all of this, assessing it, analysing it, this will help you draw a conclusion that will get you through the writer's block. Another thing that I definitely recommend is talking to someone about it. Writing is a very solitary thing. You sit down alone, you write alone, and it's all stuck there in your head. You may conclude from that that nobody wants to hear about your writer's block, but let me assure you, they do. The people who care for you want you to progress and they want you to succeed. And if you go to those people and explain the problem, you are one step closer to getting past it, because a problem shared is a problem halved, and they can give you a perspective that you potentially can't see. It's always good to get an outside opinion, be it you getting feedback on your writing, or for solutions to problems, like writer's block. The worst that can typically happen is that they can't help you, but they will listen. And them listening is brilliant for you airing the problems and potentially getting to a solution yourself. Just audibly expressing the problem can get the solution worked out in your head, because you're speaking it. It's something I typically do when I'm writing, is when I have dialogue, I typically say it out loud to myself, because I want to hear how it goes. And hearing something be said helps you sort through it. So if you're talking to someone about it, even if they can't actually help you with the writer's block, you are expressing it, and expressing it is one step towards solving it. In general, it's always a good idea to have a support network of people to help you with writing, even if it is just people that you can talk to when you're feeling a bit glum, or if you want to bounce an idea and see how it's received. It always should be someone you trust, definitely someone you trust, but having that network makes writing that much easier, and could help prevent writer's block before it happens. You can't always prevent writer's block, of course. As I said, it will hit you at some point, but lessening the blow or avoiding certain instances of it will make your writing experience that much smoother. One thing I wouldn't recommend you do is sit down and ignore all of these things that are making it difficult to write and just write anyway, without trying to solve the things that are making the writer's block happen. It is possible to brute force your way through writer's block, but I really, really wouldn't recommend it, because it is exceptionally draining, both physically and mentally. You can just grind up writer's block until it is little more than a pile of dust that you spread before you as you destroy the wall that was stopping your progress, but destroying a wall is a lot more work and a lot more tiring and a lot more exerting than finding a ladder or finding an alternate way around it. If you're just going to smash through that wall, it's going to be an ordeal, and you are not going to be better off on the other end of it. And then when you see the second wall in the distance, you are going to look at that with dread and think, oh no, I'm going to have to smash through that one as well. Some people have got through writer's block quite successfully by just trying to smash through it, but I personally would not recommend that. Try and find out what is causing the writer's block and deal with that, rather than just crack your knuckles and soldier on, because that's going to be a painful period of time, if you even succeed. You might very well not succeed. You might devote a week to trying to blast through this wall that is writer's block and get nowhere. And that will make it even worse. That will make the wall grow even higher. It's actually a good way to visualize writer's block as a wall that you have to overcome. I wouldn't recommend blasting it to pieces. I definitely wouldn't recommend taking a pickaxe to it. As I said, get a ladder, find a way around it, go and seek out the portcullis so that you can go through that way, with somebody's help to open up the portcullis. Diagnosing the writer's block is the best way to treating the writer's block. And once you're done with it, and you've managed to overcome it, you will know for next time what in that instance caused writer's block for you, and you will work to avoid it next time. You will change how you write, or you will see the warning signs coming in advance, and you'll be able to prepare for it. Knowing what's coming that could cause this makes it so much easier to manage, and will help you get back to writing sooner. Now, all the things that I have said here are not the exhaustive list of causes for writer's block. There are all manner of things that can cause it. But just remember, take a step back, figure out what's up, try and find a way to deal with it. And don't just brute force through it, unless you absolutely know that that is all you need to do. That way, you'll get past it that much faster. And so, I hope that that will help you the next time it happens. And trust me, it will happen. It's inevitable, but it's not eternal. You will get through it. I believe that you can. You will. And so, folks, when we come back, we will look at another aspect of writing. There are a few things that I have in mind, and hopefully writer's block won't get me when I'm thinking about how to structure those. You never know. But I highly hope it won't. And so, I'll catch you next time, folks, and I'll see you then. Later. Maybe you could get a sort of metaphorical helicopter to go over the writer's block wall as well. That'd be a very effective way of doing it. Or a catapult. Okay, the catapult is a bit more of a traumatic way of getting over the wall, but it would do it. Later.